Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today we continue with the topic Computer Vision OCR, and today we will look at the solution that Amazon offers, the name Textract. Let's go. So similarly to other providers, we had a service in Amazon named Amazon Textract, as I said, and essentially is doing that. It's not mixing with other kind of tags like object recognition or face recognition or landscape recognition that other is doing. It's just purely text extraction from images and files. Images, similarly like the other providers, GPG, PNG and others, and files PDF and TIFF. Similarly to other providers as well, you will need to have a storage, an S3 bucket in this case, to deposit files, because files, especially files, multi-pages files, need to be deposited or placed in a bucket, in a folder, and it's the only way that you can use the service, having them in a file. You can you can send the endpoint images, a single file with just one page, but in case that the document has multiple pages, you need to have the file into the Docker. Okay, similarly to other services, as obviously you need to have an account in Amazon. For those that are familiar with Amazon, well, this as well will be a repetition of what you know, and then, but well, in any case, you need to enroll. To enroll Amazon is pretty simple. You just need to create an account, introduce your card. In time no grown, Amazon is not offering credit, so you will start paying from the beginning. So just in case that you are really clear that you are going to use the service, do follow this video, just in case that you have already a use case or a project where you need to use this. The service is integrating perfectly with other services like Atenea or whatever, or S3 Bucket or Lambda Function. Whatever you have in Amazon is very well integrated, as it can be in other way, with the Textract, and there is multiple examples, and the documentation is really good in Amazon, so you can follow the documentation to do everything, and it will correctly explain it. Again, you need an account. Here you don't need to activate the API. You pay as you go. So the only thing that you need to do is set up the account, and then on as I'm going to point you out how to do it. You need to have a command line interface configured in your computer if you want to access from your computer programmatically to the API. But like in any other cloud provider, they have an SDK, they have a library, both of three, probably you are familiar with them as well. Everything that you need to go is as well authenticated, and to do that you need to set up your credentials on your computer, and to do that, well, they usually first of all is creating a user, and secondly setting or configuring the credentials in your local environment. So to create a user, let's go. Well, again, I will put you all these links and reference to in the notebook I will post later on the video, in the video description, and then on it will be easy to follow. Again, it's pretty easy to follow the Amazon documentation, and well, for those that are not familiar, they will have no problem in order to do this. Similarly as well to other, like other providers, there is multiple ways to authenticate yourself versus Amazon, and then well, I will explain you how I usually do it, but well, again, the same that in other providers, you have multiple ways to do this, no? So the first thing that you need to do is go to the Identity and Access Management EIN and create a user. It's obviously this after creating the account, no? And then you create a user. In this case, I create this. I'm using these services for many years, so but I currently I just enter from time to time. I just need to activate the some of these keys to record this video. And then you create a user, you attach some roles. Well, in this case, this user had kind of developed super access because I used it before for other activities with SageMaker, with code builder, sorry, and accessing as well to S3 buckets. So it had you need to look at exactly which kind of access you want to do, you want to provide to the user. But well, again, in the documentation you had pretty well, in the links I patch you had pretty well explained how to do this. Again, so also once you have the user created, the thing that you need to do is create a key, an access key, and this once you create the access key, you will get a password that you will see only one time. So take note of that, and with these two values together with the region where you want to operate the service, keep in mind the same as with other cloud providers, the region is key for the cross-border payments, no? You have to access a service which is included in a, for example, in West Europe, with this South London, South UK, and you have to access data that is in the States. There is a fee to move the data in between regions, so be aware of these topics. The same I advise you to take a look to these configurations, because always there is payments in you need to move data in between regions. So this is part of the cloud administration. It's not related with the video, but just I just remind you this, no? So that's why as well you probably need to have, depending on how is the configuration of your company, you will need to have multiple users, multiple access with different profiles depending on the activity or depending the application, depending the how this is configured, no? So in any case, you will need a user, an access key, and the password for that access key, and as well a region where the service is going to operate. What more? Once you have this created, you need to set that in your computer. AWS CLI, this is a binary you install on Windows, Mac, or Linux. And with this application, you've essentially defined the profile of the different profiles that you will be using when you connect to AWS, and you will have to say specify on the application which profile is going to use. Every profile essentially contains is a section in your credential file and configuration file. There is two files that later on I will show you. Usually, for example, in Windows is in the folder in the username root folder in the directory that AWS. There is two files, config and credential. The same approach follows in Linux or macOS, and these two files contain the different profiles that you have defined. In my case, I only had one. the rest I deleted long ago. But again, you had a default profile and then on multiple other profiles, depending the well, even if you had multiple accounts in Amazon, you had everything set up, and from there you just specify the profile you are gonna use, like I have here, for example, like this. This is the configuration of the file, which is already here. Well, you had a default profile with your credentials and different profiles depending how you had your company or the project that you are working on is configured. No? So this is previous to use the service. You had to have this configured. I will give you these links, and you can follow them in the and follow the Amazon documentation that is really well explained. You will have essentially no problem. In any case, I'm thinking how to do some videos and explain how to configure this per cloud provider, because I assume that it's easy for everybody, but probably it will be better even if I create some videos and help the subscribers know how to do this easily and at least a guidance in how I'm doing, and they can replicate just and adapt it to their specific problem. Okay, so again, you will need a bucket. S3 bucket is similar service, the storage service in Amazon. For those that are familiar, you will for those that are not familiar, yes, it's just the same that Google buckets or blobs in Azure. Well, you go to the services, Amazon S3 buckets, and you create a new one. I create this one for this video, and essentially you will need to know the location of the folders and files in your bucket to later on access when you are working with Textract, the same that if you are working with any other service. The URIs you can see is pretty similar to other cloud providers, S3, that blah blah blah. It's like a URL, but just to access the location in your S3 bucket. Okay, let's move to Textract. Textract is the library that Amazon developed to use this service. This is in combination with Boto3, which is the official SDK in Python for Amazon. You can install only this, or you can install Boto3. So if you install this, you can just use the Textract features. If you install Boto3, you can use the rest of the services as well. No? We will focus in Textract only in the library, in the Python library. The same that in other cloud providers, they offer as well development in C#, in Java, in JavaScript. And I will post you as well the link of this library, and also the repository with a lot of examples. The documentation is pretty extensive, multiple examples of how to do things, and then you will see if you watch the previous videos that is pretty similar to the other the concept, and the approach is pretty similar to the other cloud providers, and you will see that it's very easy to use as well. No? So we need to install this library. Also, to install the library via PIP, they have some dependencies depending what you are going to use additionally to the to text extractor. For example, if you are going to use to extract text from PDFs, you need to install these dependencies, or if you want to use sentence transformers to understand the text that is inside the documents or images, you need to install the TORs and sentence transformers with this dependency. And if you want to extend the capabilities of the text extract, they give you the files to you, well, continue with the project in your own or whatever you need to do. In my case, I just install text extractor with the dependency, PDF dependency, because we are just replicating the same that we did with Google or with Tesseract or with Azure. Okay. Once you have this installed, it's pretty simple to use. Really, it's and again, it's just focusing in extract text from images and files, so there is no other. You don't need to learn everything that you are going to learn is connected with this capability, and there is no they are not mixing this with other activities, with other tasks, so it's pretty straightforward what you will learn. To import the library, and then on here just simply access to the profile. This is the profile that you have in your local configuration. And I'm taking, as you see here, the default, but if you had multiple profiles, you just simply need to specify here the name of the profile. Here you and this is the simple use of the libraries, like you see on the screen in the notebook. You just create an object extractor, and you just send an image to the service, to the API. And there is two ways to send requests to the API. One is a synchronous, the other is asynchronous. This is the synchronous one. And then on to do asynchronous, you need to use, in any case, the S3 bucket. And also, if you pretend to extract text from a multi-page document. Similarly to other cloud providers, you receive the response in a JSON file, in a document. You first of all, you can just print the document, and you will receive a resume of the service extracted from the image in this case. And then all you will see here is one page, this number of words, lines, and then later we will cover this. This is very interesting feature on Amazon. So the object contains an attribute response, which is essentially a very long JSON file with all the information that you need. No? And similarly to to other cloud providers, they have multiple keys with all the metadata and bounding boxes, etc., that you need to localize the text and the text in your document, no? or how the service localizes the text in your document. They're using inch, as you see here. This looking at the magnitudes of these coordinates, they are using inch. But well, you need to transform this to DPI, to pixels. It's pretty easy to do it. I already explained you how to do it in previous videos. So they organize the blocks, no? This attribute in, well, it's slightly different than others. They have pages, lines, and inside lines also they have words. This is not untypical. This is the same that other, but they make this is complex. If you want to say they cross relationships in between the objects, so from page to lines and from lines to words, which somehow is complex, no? Because if you want to parse all this JSON, you need to create some logic to find how they are connected, the different components. The good news is that Amazon already did that for you, so you don't need to do that, and this is what I will explain you later on. But I just want to tell you that if you want to create your logic to analyze and parse the JSON, it will be a little bit more complicated than with other cloud providers. So I just showing you here one of the blocks, and similarly to the others, well, is block timeline, confidence score, the text, the geometry, how to localize the text inside the image of the document versus the top left vertice of the image, and then on the relationships with, for example, here with child, etc. Well, here I make you a print. There is this attribute inside the block text, and then I just make a printout of the what is containing. Similar to other cloud providers, so some issues with the special characters, but well, this as I mentioned before, probably is not very important unless that you need them for the application that is going to consume this information, this data. The version of the model, other metadata, well, again, pretty extensive information of what the service is doing, and well, here the easiest way to access to the information is just simply get the attribute text of the object document, and you will just get a printout of the everything that contains the document. It doesn't matter it is multi-page, the text is just like the response text of the in library requests. If you just get the attribute text, that you have all the translation or the extraction, the text extraction that had your document, regardless the page, the number of pages that the document have. Here I just simply serializing the document, just to show you this is a pure JSON, and they give you as well a parser, a class, just to take the JSON and convert it back in a document object. And I will explain you right away why it's important to have this on the original document class that Amazon provides. No? Here I give you an example of the asynchronous request, pretty similar to the other. The only thing again that you need to pass an S3 upload path, where the service will keep some metadata and binary information. You can as well decide to create a copy of the image and the extraction, etc. But well, you receive it in any case as document object here. The document that you receive is slightly different. It's a wrapper. It's a lazy document. It's like the asynchronous document object is slightly different, but at the end it just contains a little bit more attributes. And in the lazy document class, you had the original document similar to what you receive in the asynchronous request in the attribute document, and you get access to the response in the same way that we do in the asynchronous request. the response is the, again, is a document object, so it's exactly the same organization that the one I showed you before. Here is when it comes some of the good features that comes with the Textract, and then you will see now, and then it's what is helping a lot and making your life very easy. So you will see here, I'm importing as well from Textract these Textract features, and then on there is multiple features that you can request to the to the API: forms, layout, queries, signature tables. So this is very interesting. So it's come ready to you work directly, for example, with invoices, forms, and as well signatures. You can do even queries. Queries is something that I never see in other, or I didn't see in other providers. Actually, you simply send a query with the, it's a regular expression, and it will return you, or more than return you, it will create specific bounding boxes across the text or sections of the document that match with your query. Pretty interesting, and it comes as well with a visualization tool which help you a lot to parse the documents and localize the information. So here, to do this, first of all, you need to to specify this shape underscore image equal true, and then on here I just make an example with another document. It's just an statement. I don't know from where I take it from, but it doesn't matter. It's just an statement from Barclays card. And well, you can see here you send the image, it's an image local. You send as well to analyze document, you ask some features, forms, tables, and layout, and say the image true, which will help you. This, what it's doing is saving in a binary format all this information that the service gathered from your image, and later on you can visualize with the visualization tool. So I open the original image just to you show you how it looks like, and then on when you click documents, if you send the request in the way that I send it, it's starting to recognize some of these checkboxes, table, queries, signatures. It is an identity document, or it is an expense document, no? And then if you don't send these features, you will not see this. How to say? You will always see zeros in these other attributes of the document. Only sending in the request, or specifying in the request that you want to extract specific features, you will get it here later on the document object. And then on. To visualize these attributes, you can see here that it found some tables, and then when you write document tables visualize, it's using the visualization tool and giving you the three tables that the service found in the document. You can request as well key values. Key values is not it's not a feature, it's just is a capability that always or is a task that is always doing the tool, and is just signaling to a specific key parts of the test that it recognize according to the configuration, the default configuration that the tool had. You can change this behavior in the request, but it's specifying the documentation how you can get that. And the layout is something similar to what we did in previous videos. It's just write down bounding boxes, and it's pretty extensive the information that is provided. So how is where the tables, where the different words and also the text as if extracted from the different bounding boxes. So if you saw the videos I show you before with Tesseract or with Azure, this is something that you need to code and prepare yourself. Here they do it for you. So it's saving a lot of time in case that you need to debug or to try to find out why one document or what the tool is extracting. Is helping you a lot, and you can do this offline. You just take the JSON file. You don't need to send the request again. You just can save the JSON to local, use the parser to load it in and transform it into a document, and then use these tools to analyze and debug the tool and the debug the library and how it's extracting. I find it pretty interesting, pretty easy to use this. Then on, as I said you before, if you want to use to find or to send analyze documents with multiple pages, you need to use you need to have them in a S3 bucket. I just uploaded it to this folder in here in Amazon. I have multiple documents. I just take one, the same example that previous videos, and then on I use in this case another tool. It you see here the documentation, essentially there is all these tools. They are also command line tools. You can use them via command lines once you install the library, and then on in that case I just use the color. And then, well, it's as simple than this. It's the same that the previous request you saw before. It's just always an asynchronous call, asynchronous request, and you need to specify the URI of your file in Amazon. The URI is similar is an standard, so you just need to specify S3. This is the bucket name, OCR extraction or not. This is the folder. This is the name of the file. And at the end, you get a JSON file. Here you transform it to document, and once you have your document, is exactly the same that you saw before. As you remember, in document metadata you get the number of pages, and well, once you had the JSON analysis, is exactly the same that before. You see here I just print out as well the document, and one thing I wanted to point you out as well, in previous videos, probably you remember I commend you that, for example, Google, when analyze this document, the same document, this part here and this part here, Google, for example, consider like two different columns, no? And this, in many cases, cause problems or generate a problem, because later on you had to rebuild or to correctly rebuild the information or to place the information in the correct side. So the way, for example, that Google is doing, just you take the document, you extract the text, and you will see introduction, PII central role, blah 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 blah. When it finished here in non-public approach, start with the numbers of the pages. And then what is the problem with that? That, well, in this case probably is a teeny problem, but in case that you are using, for example, a transformer, it's important to have the information correctly placed because the location matters, no? And then there is the attention mechanism somehow is a little bit misled if you just send information without fixing this problem. In many other cases, probably it will be not a problem, but I just wanted to point you out that it later on, depending what is going to be the consumer of your information, it will be needed to fix it. In the case of Amazon, it's doing correctly. You see here introduction and then on comes 1815, no? So you see here the extraction is doing correctly. In the case of the other providers, you will need to see what's going on with this. It's important to you look at these details because it could cause different problems depending on the application which is on consume the information. It's just an advice because I faced these problems on the past, and then some of the especially well, in that case was with Google. I was using at that time this service. This is something that caused me a lot of problems when to had to deal with information. Also, this is general for any of these services. There is a lot of issues with tables. I think I mentioned before how the information that is included in tables is parsed. It's really a nightmare in many cases. Other problem as well is if you work with, for example, with Excel, and you create very, very narrow, very small cells, and there is numbers which practically are occupying the whole cell. Later on, the tool, the OCR tool, is going to be misleading, and it will not extract correctly the text. There was a lot of improvements. Believe me, 5 years ago, 4 years ago, that was the services had very bad quality. Now it's much, much better. They improve it a lot, but again, it's a good how to say advice to you go through the extraction with multiple examples before you decide to apply one of these technologies to your data pipeline or to your project, because the perfect solution is still not there. There is still room to improve, and the same that other providers, Amazon is doing changes constantly, and yeah, you need to read the documentation, and also this kind of details you have to keep an eye on that, and depending on the documentation that you're analyzing, it will be more or less key in your data pipeline. Well, that is all for today. I hope you like it, and I hope you like the content. I hope you like the topic. I think with this we will be finishing this topic OCR, and we move to other interesting topics. And well, as in other videos, thank you for watching, and if you like the content, just hit me a like and subscribe to the channel if you didn't do that before. Thank you.